to you by Penguin.
The War Against the BBC by Patrick Barwise and Peter York. Read by Neil Gardner. Chapter 1. What exactly is the BBC? The BBC was launched in October 1922 as a private business, the British Broadcasting Company, by a consortium of radio manufacturers. Its commercial role as the only UK broadcaster licensed by the General Post Office, GPO, which was responsible at that time for regulating the airwaves, was to drive consumer purchases of radios. In December 1922, the BBC, astonishingly, appointed as its general manager 33-year-old Captain John Reith, a charismatic, 6-foot-6-inches tall Scottish Presbyterian Conservative with virtually no relevant experience but limitless self-belief, as he doubtless made clear at the interview. The gamble paid off. Reith led the BBC until 1938, and it is still recognisably his creation. In particular, it was Reith who determined that its overall mission, even as a private company, should be public service, using its programmes to inform, educate, and entertain its audiences. This remains its mission today. The initial funding for the service was provided from a royalty on the sale of radio sets from the 6 manufacturers in the consortium, but this proved insufficient as many listeners used unlicensed or homemade radios and was soon replaced by an annual radio license fee paid over the counter at post offices, broadly similar to today's TV license fee. Any household with a working radio was legally required to have a license. Almost everything about the BBC, its funding, its scope, and the nature and social and political effects of its programming, has always been contested right from the start. For instance, concerns about its market impact go back to its foundation. To protect newspapers' revenue, it was banned from selling radio advertising and from presenting any news bulletins before 7 p.m. Initially, it was even required to source all its news from commercial wire services rather than setting up its own news-gathering operation. In line with its mission, the BBC's programming was strongly skewed towards high culture. Reith believed that part of its role was to develop its listeners' tastes by offering them programmes slightly more demanding than they would have listened to if they'd had a choice. Even after the First World War, British society was still sufficiently deferential for this paternalistic approach to have been largely uncontroversial, although there was, as there always will be, a tension between challenging the audience and maximising the number of listeners, or viewers, by giving them less demanding fare. 1927. The British Broadcasting Corporation. On the 1st of January 1927, the BBC became, as it still remains, the British Broadcasting Corporation, a statutory public corporation with a royal charter, and therefore independent from direct government interference. Although, as with all public institutions, especially public broadcasters, its relationship with the government and politicians is inherently problematic, as we'll discuss shortly. The BBC Charter is reviewed every 10 years or so. Under the current one, which runs from the 1st of January 2017 until the 31st of December 2027, the BBC is governed by the BBC Board and regulated by the communications regulator Ofcom, has 5 non-commercial divisions: content, TV channels and programmes, radio and education, news and current affairs, including BBC Global News, nations and regions, and a group covering digital technology and services and functions such as research and development, finance, HR, and property. Has 3 commercial divisions: BBC Studios, TV production and international commercial activities, BBC World News, commercial TV news production and distribution, and BBC Studio Works, TV production facilities, and is funded by a combination of TV license fees and the profits from its commercial activities. The BBC is the original and archetypal public service broadcaster, PSB, that is, as a broadcaster managed and regulated to be universally available and to deliver explicit public service objectives in addition to those delivered by a purely commercial broadcaster, but editorially independent of government. Thanks to Reith, the BBC was a PSB under this definition even as a private company, as ITV and Channel 5 still are today. It is widely recognised as the most famous and prestigious PSB in the world, the biggest in terms of its international reach outside its home country, and, at least in broad terms, the model for PSBs around the world. A PSB or a state broadcaster? A key issue is, inevitably, the BBC's relationship with the British government, especially the extent to which it really is an editorially independent PSB as opposed to a government-controlled state broadcaster. It is, of course, publicly owned and, as we've just described, it operates under a number of government-determined conditions, its periodically reviewed charter and core funding, and much of its governance and regulation. However, only the most paranoid conspiracy theorist would describe the BBC as a state broadcaster in the sense that, say, CCTV, China Central Television, or RT, formerly Russia Today, is a state broadcaster. CCTV is directly controlled by the Chinese state and the Communist Party, which itself controls the state, and explicitly works to their agenda. RT is part of TV Novosti, in principle an autonomous non-profit organisation, but seen by almost everyone outside Russia as a government propaganda outlet and often accused of spreading disinformation, for example, about the Skripal poisonings in Salisbury. A closer case is the portfolio of international US government-funded networks, such as Voice of America and Radio Free Europe, operated by the US Agency for Global Media, USAGM. Long seen internationally as a US government propaganda vehicle, the USAGM is now also a domestic political issue because of two recent changes. First, since 2013, its services have been available within the US. Secondly, since June 2020, its head has been Donald Trump's nominee, Michael Pack, a conservative filmmaker with close links to Trump's former chief strategist, Steve Bannon, who we'll meet again in Chapter 14. If Trump is re-elected in 2020, the chance of the USAGM not being widely seen as a Trump propaganda outlet is, in our view, close to zero. As we'll discuss, the BBC has itself been repeatedly accused of peddling British state propaganda, or at least censoring information the UK government wanted suppressed, and not only by foreign demagogues and dictators. One critic was George Orwell, author of Animal Farm and 1984, who worked there during the Second World War. George Orwell, From Catalonia to Room 101. In November 2017, a statue of Orwell was unveiled outside Broadcasting House, where he worked from August 1941 to November 1943. Inscribed on the wall next to it is a quotation of his: "If liberty means anything at all, it means the right to tell people what they do not want to hear." Orwell is admired by people with strongly conflicting views, on the left and the right, who nevertheless often claim that, if he were alive today, he would agree with whatever it is they're saying. This includes his presumed views of the BBC now. He certainly hated his time working there during the war and resigned because he could no longer bear wasting my own time and the public money on doing work that produces no results. However, that certainly doesn't mean he would have agreed with today's Beeb bashers. His son, Richard Blair, present at the statue's unveiling, told reporters...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.